Okay, hello and welcome to another Sales Inside Expert interview. Today I'm joined by Torben Wiese, who is in Copenhagen in Denmark. Hey Torben, yeah. How are you doing?
Hi, I'm fine. Happy to be with you.
Great. And I think, Torben, you're my first interview from Denmark, so there's another first. Excellent. So Torben has written a number of books, Break Your Habits, Reach Your Goals, and Bend the Fish While It's Fresh, a very interesting title. You'll have to explain that one in a moment. Torben talks a lot about change, and he has a particular perspective of, you know, where change comes to. And, you know, obviously we talk a lot about sales, so we want to talk about change as it relates to sales. So my name is John Golden, SalesPOP Online, Sales Magazine, Pipeliner CRM. Okay, so Torben, first explain to me the title of the book, Bend the Fish While It's Fresh, and then we'll get into the discussion on change.
Yeah, that one is actually very interesting to salespeople because it is about being mentally present. The proverb is from Tanzania, where the local fishermen, they catch a long fish, and immediately they caught it, they bent the tail of the fish, then they smoke the fish in big ovens they have by the river, and the fish gets stiff, so they can hang it on a stick and carry it back to the village.
Ah.
But it's also a pronunciation of being mentally present, because we have the past and we have the future, but if I want to be a good salesperson, I have to be 100% mentally present.
Yeah.
And I meet a lot of salespeople who are not. They think about what I'm going to do in a second or two, or they might think, wow, I got it. And then they're not mentally present, and the customer says, oh, we think about it.
Yeah. So so just on that point to be mentally present, because I think it's a very critical point, right? So it's one thing to be mentally present when we're face-to-face, right? And you can still wander off in your head. But a lot of sales and interaction is conducted now, you know, through, you know, web technologies like this, like Skype or WebEx or telephones. How much more difficult is it for salespeople to be mentally present? Because there's all these other distractions. It's very easy for me to talk to you and then to be glancing over at my email and thinking about something else. So how big a challenge is that, and how do you overcome that?
I think it's more and more a big challenge, but maybe not for me, but more to get the customer into to the present moment,
right?
Because he or she has the mind of the next meeting,
sure,
or the supplier they have now. So the whole time he or she is sitting evaluating me, do they like me more or less, or is this good or bad, and how long do I need to keep him on the line to until I can say goodbye. So it's more a matter of, I need to be mentally present, but also how can I check if my customer or my coming customer is mentally present? So it's about eye contact. It's about listening to bits of words, the tonation, and also asking things and keeping the whole time, of course, professional and talking into his or her situation.
Mm-hmm.
So it's very interesting. So their mind will not go this or this way. If I want to go to the future, it should be more about possibilities they could,
sure,
gain with me, or problems they want to avoid.
Mm-hmm.
But I need him or her to be mentally present to think about the future.
Right. And so to have them mentally present, you obviously, first off, you have to be very disciplined and be very present yourself, right? Otherwise, you know, that's not going to work. So let's talk a little bit about change, because we were just talking briefly before we came on air about your approach to change, right? And, you know, often in organizations, and this is true for sales, it's true for any other organization, people often think of change as something external, right? It's something that's imposed upon them, or, you know, there's a new initiative and there's going to be a change manager put in place, so all the change is going to be handled by someone else, right?
Yeah.
But that's not the perspective you come from, correct?
Well, 2,500 years ago, a Greek philosopher, Heraclitus, he said the only constant thing is change.
Mm-hmm.
The only constant thing is change. And I think it's more true than ever. Changes are coming faster and faster. And the interesting thing as a salesperson is, also as a private person, but we're looking at the salesperson now, is how do I deal with changes?
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of companies, they tell the salespeople, you need to be ready to change.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, we need to be ready. But being ready for me is more like nowadays, more like, well, I'm ready. I just haven't seen it coming yet.
Mm-hmm.
And as a guy said last week, he said at a seminar, he said, I'm waiting aggressively. I'm so ready. but if you're only ready, it's a bit black and white example, but if you're only ready, you will always be behind. Mm-hmm. You'll wait for the competitors to come up with new products, then you come with it. You lose an order, then you get better. You get problems with your heart, then you get into better shape. So I think it's more, if we know everybody's changing, also the way we sell with social media and so on, but also the way we communicate and networking and so on, we need to create change before we are changed. And that's one of the, I think, the most important advantages we can have as salespeople, to be the people who really, when we call a customer or a coming customer, they think, thank you for calling me because you helped me to change.
Right.
Yeah. So, but on the other side of all the changes, we have our habits, and that's what's really interesting. Mm-hmm. The habits that the brain love habits, because it saves energy. Each time we can do what we normally do, we save energy, and it feels safe to do what we normally do. Mm-hmm. And to feel safe is the most it's an internal need we have. The most to feel safe. We also need sleep and coffee and mm-hmm. and food and so on. But a mental need is to feel safe.
Right.
And the brain thinks, do what you normally do and you get what you normally get. Mm-hmm. That's what my brain and your brain thinks. Our brain is designed 100,000 years ago. In those days, it were version 1.0. and it's still 1.0. So the brain works as it did 100,000 years ago. So my brain thinks, Torben, do what you normally did and you get what you normally mm-hmm. got. But nowadays, it's totally different.
Mm-hmm. And so on that point then, you know, so with salespeople, obviously there are change initiatives that come with organizations, you know, change sales processes, change approaches, maybe launch new products. But to your point, a lot of change has to come from within yourself, right? You have to make the decision that you want to get ahead of things, that you want to adapt to the changing environment.
Yeah.
So how much of real change comes down to taking personal responsibility?
I can't say a percentage,
sure.
But a lot of big things will be changed in companies. That comes from the CRM systems,
sure.
or to buying a competitor or new products. But if we still think selling is an eye-to-eye contact sport, or mm-hmm. then it's into my it's I really have to look at myself 100% and get myself. It could be on video. Look at myself. Listen to myself on my phone, on how do my voice sound, get feedback on my clothes, get feedback on how I smell, get feedback on how, if I listen to people, if I use what they say as buying signals, or how do I overcome or objections and so on. Small things that will get me to a big success.
Right.
I can only, if I win an order, I have 100% responsibility. If I lose it, it's also my responsibility. So the whole time, just as a professional football player or
sure.
tennis player, in Denmark we have Caroline Wozniacki.
Mm-hmm.
She's 100% perfect, not perfect, but professional. And the whole time she gets feedback. Even though she's number one, she keeps on getting. So I should take 100% responsibility for my change, and change before I get changed.
Yeah, and that kind of neatly ties in with what you were saying about habits, right? Because let's face it, we're very good at coming up with other reasons why things didn't work out, right? Say we lose a sale. Well, it wasn't really my fault. There were these other circumstances in place.
Yeah.
So we're pretty good at that. And then, as you say, we're quite likely to go to the next opportunity and executed in pretty much the same way. So how do you get out, or how do you break habits?
There are three types of habits. There are the physical ones. That's all you can see me do now, how I do it with my hands and eye contact and my voice and so on. Also my handshake and lots of the physical habits. Then we have the mental habits, how I think. How do I think, positive or negative? Do I think constructive or destructive? What do I think when I see a salesperson? A lot of people say no.
Yeah.
get away. Others might think, well, you're welcome. That's a thinking habits. And then we have how we feel. Do I feel nervous? Do I feel safe? Do I feel happy or sad? So that's the three types of habits we have. The physical ones, the way we think, and the way we feel. And when I ask salespeople about their habits, mention me three good habits, for instance, they always mention physical habits.
Right.
I have full eye contact. I'm a very good listener. I come on time, or which I would say might be good habits.
Sure.
Not so much on the internal habits, what we could call them that. For instance, in Scandinavia, we asked 1,500 salespeople about objections. Mm-hmm. In every good sales conversation, there will be objections.
Sure.
But many salespeople don't like objections because they feel it as a fear. Yeah, they feel it can stop the conversation.
Triggers a defensive mechanism, right?
Yeah. So we asked them, these 1,500 salespeople, could you please mention some of the most common objections you get? And more than 90% said, yes, when the customer says you're too expensive. Mm-hmm. You're too expensive. We also get that. I think you get that too where you live. You're too expensive. And then we asked, okay, interesting. What do you say when you get that objection? What do you say? So like right away.
Sure.
In the moment of truth. You don't have time to think. It's a habit reaction. And it showed that more than 80% answered when they get this objection, you're too expensive. Then the salespeople say, compared to what? Compared to what? And it's a way of, they don't think about it. It's a habit. It's just, we asked them, not in the same survey, but at seminars, we asked them, why do you want to say compared to what?
Mm-hmm.
And the answer is, well, I feel somebody is stagging me. It's a, they are attacking me. And I want
defend yourself. Yeah.
To defend myself.
Yeah, yeah.
So I said, compared to what? And I said, 2 weeks ago, there were five different countries and people from five different countries. And I said to them, do you really want to hear compared to what? And some said, well, I don't know, because when I say to a customer, compared to what? Then the customer start answering, compared to the supply we have now, mm-hmm. compared to the service you have told me you have, compared to that my daughter works in that company, compared to, and the same people more like to say, no, stop, I have heard enough.
Exactly.
So that's a kind of, we call it habit manuscripts, that in many situations, it is written in our brains, what you and I will do in a second or two.
Mm-hmm.
So what we need to be able to as salespeople, as I see it, is to look at ourselves from outside
right.
as a fly on the wall. And when a customer tells me, Torben, it's interesting, but you're too expensive.
Right.
My voice went to say, now I'm all say, oh, John, I'm really glad you bring up price and economy because it's also important to us.
Mm-hmm.
Before I answer that, could I please ask you one question? What's most important to you? Is that the total economy with your supplier and the partner, or is it the price per unit?
Right.
And then shut up.
Mm-hmm.
And then normally, I hope the customer will say, well, it's a total economy.
Right.
Because what idea is it to get a low price if you don't get it on right delivery time and so on? So this, if I want to say that to a customer, I'm really glad you bring up the price and economy. What's most important to you? Is that the total economy in a working relationship, or is it more the price per unit?
Yeah.
I really need to put my feelings outside the office.
Yeah, but in that scenario, so you have, if you take the two scenarios, so the first one when I say compared to what?
Yeah.
I'm being defensive, right? And now I've made you the prospect or the buyer. I've made you feel uncomfortable too, because now you're defensive, because now you're going to justify why, right?
Yeah, exactly.
The second one that you said, you don't get defensive. In fact, you look like you welcome the question, and then you pose a question and you give them time to think. So then they go, yeah, which is more important to me? right? So it's a lot more it's a lot more comfortable and positive, right?
That's what I hope. So it's not always working, of course. But in my business, I will always meet the same 10 or 12 objections. Mm-hmm. So I have prepared, when a customer say this, I say this. When a customer says this, I say this, and so on. I know you know all about this, John. So, but I've done the same. And also often in my business as a speaker, I know some objections will come up automatically.
Sure.
So I bring them up, some of them, before they ask me. Mm-hmm. They, for instance, often ask, do you have references in England? I know some companies will ask that.
Sure.
And so I bring up that. You might be wondering if I have references in England. Mm-hmm. Is that so? And they say yes. And it shows that I'm not afraid of that.
Yeah.
It shows that I'm prepared. And of course, I have brought some references, and by the way, they're all positive.
Yeah, of course. So that neatly ties in also with what you were saying earlier about, you know, habits being comfort zones for us, right? It's somewhere where we feel comfortable, and I guess that's one of the things that we need to overcome, is that we shouldn't be looking to feel comfortable. We should be looking to, you know, really engage and not just fall back on things that make us feel comfortable that may actually cost us deals in the end.
It might, yeah. Mm-hmm. It feels safe, but it might not be real safe. Mm-hmm. Real safety nowadays is to find outside the comfort zone, just outside. All the habits are inside the comfort zone. It's not that everything should be changed.
Sure.
I think you call it a changeaholic. Everybody wants to change and change just to change.
Yeah, yeah.
Changes can give new impulses and new ideas. But I think I often talk with my clients about when is a habit good or bad. Mm-hmm. Because all habits feel good. You can't mention one habit that doesn't feel good.
Right.
Some say, well, smoking isn't a good habit, and I might agree on that.
Yeah.
But when you smoke, it feels good.
Sure.
So, but you might feel bad afterwards. So a good habit helps us to reach our goals. A bad habit or destructive habit, it makes me not reach my goal. Yeah. So good habits, they help me. Destructive habits, they do the opposite.
So
what I need to do is to have goals. Not only I need to sell for $1 million, or, mm-hmm. but also what kind of, how many laughs would I like to have in this talk? How many smiles? How many accepts? How many?
Yeah.
Not only at the end of the meeting, I got him or her to sign. Might be the main goal in the end, but
so putting in milestones and incremental ones. So it's a good. So out of this, anyone listening, it might be a good exercise to maybe take a look at yourself as a salesperson and say, okay, let me look at the habits I have today, and let me separate which are good habits, you know, such as I do great preparation and call planning for every call. Fantastic habit, right? You know, when I get the price question, I have a habit of getting defensive. Okay, bad habit. Need to check on that one. So I think that'll be a great exercise for people, is to separate the good habits from the bad habits and look at trying to eliminate some of those bad habits.
Yeah.
Okay, well, we're bumping up against the end of the time. So, Torben, I wanted to give you a few moments to tell people a little bit more about yourself, what you do, and how they can find out more about you.
Yeah. Well, I can just add one thing, John.
Sure.
That the most difficult habit to change is the one you don't know about. Mm-hmm. So it is a matter of the whole time watching yourself from outside, asking others, seeing yourself on video and taking you on the phone, listening to your voice and so on, getting feedback and asking for it.
Yeah. Yeah. And just, sorry, just on that point, because that's a critical point, is I think you mentioned professional, you know, players and all of that, sports people or whatever. I definitely think salespeople need to do a better job of taking some accountability for themselves. Like you said, everybody nowadays can record themselves. Everybody can video themselves. Everybody can reach out to their sales manager and say, can you listen in on the next call I do and give me some feedback? So I think we got to be a little more proactive, right?
Yeah.
All right. So go ahead.
Well, I've been working in sales since I was 16. So that's more than 14 years in sales and in sales management and so on. And I really like selling. But now mostly of the time I do sales training, and I do a lot of seminars with from six people up to 2,000 people. And that's really what's interesting me now, to give people new inspiration, motivation, and tools in a short while. That's a really interesting for me, I think. And I have a web page, maybe you put it there. It's called habitmanager.com, where you can find different literature and articles and so on. You're welcome.
All right. Listen, that's great, Torben. Thank you for joining me this evening in Copenhagen. I hear it's still morning in San Diego.
Yeah.
But pleasure talking with you, and hopefully we can talk again soon.
I would like that.
All right. Thank you.
Have a nice day.
You too. So I encourage you to subscribe to salespop.net, the online sales magazine. Also subscribe to our YouTube channel, and then comment. Get involved in the conversation. Love to hear what you have to say.